out once.
She failed self-injury, and from the East Palo Alto Police Department, Chief Ronald Day.
Thank you.
Stay and spell your name.
Good afternoon. My name is Harold Schapelhoman. First name is spelled H-A-R-O-L-D. Last name is spelled S-C-H-A-P-E-L-H-O-U-M-A-N. I'm the fire chief for the Menlo Park Fire Protection District. Fire District serves East Palo Alto, Menlo Park, Atherton, and portions of the county. At 7:54 this morning, we had a report to our dispatch center that we had an aircraft that had impacted a high power tension line in the city of East Palo Alto in an area at the end of Beach Street, which is a residential community near the San Francisco Bay, right along San Francisco Creek. We had a heavy fog condition this morning. At that point, once the initial call came in, several minutes later, we had another report down the street on Beach Street that we had an explosion on the street. We dispatched two first alarm assignments, which is essentially five pieces of equipment to each one of those incidents. Total about 25 personnel that were responding to both those incidents right after 7:54. At 8:01 this morning, our first arriving engine company, our engine 2, based out of East Palo Alto, arrived on the street. With the heavy fog condition, until they actually got up on the incident, they didn't know exactly what they had. They arrived on scene at the end of the street. They reported they had multiple structures on fire on the street. We had a structure behind me to my right, to your left, and behind me to your left, my right. The structure on the on my left side here, that's where the aircraft is impacted. At this point, we know there are three fatalities in the fuselage, found the fuselage of the aircraft. Apparently, the aircraft, it looks like, impacted a high power tension line to the end of Beach Street that runs along the bay. We have a power tower that's collapsed. It looks like it's about an 80 to 100 foot tower that's collapsed, so it's collapsed at the midpoint. When the lines came down, we had a serious situation out there because the lines were still energized. So PG&E has been trying to deal with de-energizing the power lines because the ground, actually, if someone would have walked on it, they would have been electrocuted by the high power tension line. So it was a serious situation. Aircraft continued downward. At 1225 Beach Street, we found the remnants of a wing that has impacted the rear portion of a single-story, four-bedroom residential structure. Early reports, we had seven people in that house. We've confirmed we actually had three people in that house. Directly behind 1225 on the same lot as a child daycare center, there was no one at the daycare center, fortunately, this morning. We have subsequently also had, at 1225, we had a working structure fire. The structure fire is damaged with fire, about 50% of the residential structure. The entire structure, though, has been damaged by smoke, heat, and water, so it's a complete loss to that residential structure. Next door to that, as you come up the street, on that same side of the street at 1215, we have a carport that was impacted by what looks like a fuselage and portions of a landing gear. We also see what we think is the motor of the aircraft. Looks like the landing gear, when it came down, hit the parking garage, ripped it off the home itself, separated by about 6 to 10 feet, and it landed on top of a vehicle. So it's collapsed with portions of the landing gear on top and underneath it and through the actual carport. Next door to that, at 1203 Beach Street, we have what we believe is the motor of the aircraft. Actually, when it came down, it went through portions of a garage and is wedged in into the garage from the side where it looks like the trajectory is from 1215 to 1215 side on Beach. Both of those structures did not catch on fire, and that was that information. We didn't find out we had parts there until later on as we started to scour the neighborhood to find out where the parts were. Once those pieces came off the aircraft, it looks like the aircraft progressed down into the street here on Beach Street and actually ended up landing somewhere, impacting somewhere around 1180 Beach Street, which is to my left here, again to your right. When the aircraft impacted the ground, we're not sure exactly what happened, but we know that aviation fuel was either spread or distributed to the front of the structure. So the entire front of the structure caught on fire, including the vegetation in the front of that structure, which had a small retaining wall of about 3 feet, 4 feet in height, actually deflected the forward progression of the aircraft as it proceeded down the street, kind of ricocheted off that wall a little bit, skidding along the sidewalk. At that point, it stopped and impacted three vehicles. All three of those vehicles caught on fire. The aircraft was on fire, the home was on fire, and the fire spread to vegetation next door to 1180 Beach Street, and including burning portions of the structure. So again, on arrival, we had multiple fires, two structure fires, three vehicles on fire, the aircraft on fire, and vegetation on fire. We dispatched out a third alarm. We set up a multi-casualty area, but miraculously, and this is the fortunate part of this event today, because the aircraft landed in the street, this could have been a far worse event had it landed inside this residential neighborhood. It impacted structures and would have probably killed multiple people had it done so. We evacuated people out of the first home. We evacuated people out of these other homes that were impacted. We evacuated portions of the neighborhood. But again, miraculously, no one on the ground was either injured or killed in this event, so we feel very fortunate. Now, that said, once we remove the bodies and the aircraft, when NTSB gets here this afternoon, we'll be checking under and around those vehicles to make sure that we're not missing anyone. Right now, we have no reports of anyone that's gone missing or is unaccounted for, but we'll take a precautionary measure to make sure that we check that. We downscaled from a third alarm because we didn't need it, although we were ready for it. We did not have a multi-casualty event. We were ready for it. We didn't need it. At this point, unless you have any questions, I'll ask Chief Davis to come up as well. And again, in terms of victims, we do have three victims in the aircraft. They're in the fuselage portion of the aircraft. The aircraft was damaged because of both the impact to the power line, maybe the power pole, certainly the ground, but also was significantly damaged and burned down because of the fire. Is there any questions?
Just so one clarification. I thought I heard you say that you had an injury.
We have at 12:25, we have a wing. At 12:15, we have portions of the fuselage and land. It looks like one landing gear. And then next door to that, into the structure at 12:03, looks like the motor has gone through the garage in there, through the sidewall, looks like. It's impacted through the sidewall. So whether it ricocheted and continued forward from 12:15 to 12:03, that's kind of what it looks like. We'll let NTSB tell us exactly.
This was a twin engine plane, as I understand.
That's what we're hearing. I can't confirm that.
Okay. Are we nobody in any of the structures that were hit, or just lucky that nobody got killed?
We have no one injured. We have no one killed on the ground. And again, I think it's to some degree we feel very lucky. It's a miracle that no one was killed. It's a highly densely populated residential neighborhood. It's at a period of time when people are leaving for school at 7:54. Kids are going to school. You know, the adults are going to work and so forth. So we feel very fortunate that we did not have a multi-casualty event out here. We had significant fire problem. We had significant impact to structures based upon the debris field. But overall, unfortunately for the victims in the aircraft, they've obviously are deceased, but outside of that, no one in the residential neighborhood was impacted. I've worked with the district for 29 years, and in all the years that I've worked both out here and in the district, we have never had an aircraft impact the residential community here. We have had multiple aircraft crashes that have come out of Palo Alto Airport, either on landing or takeoff, into San Francisco Creek, into the Thule area, the marsh area out here, or actually in the bay itself. We have had fatality accidents in the past in the water, in the creek, and in the Thule area. We've had to pull those people out of there. At the same time, we've had people have walked away. So this is one of the more significant aircraft crashes that we've had just because it's impacted the residential neighborhood. We have had an event about 20 years ago. I think we lost five people in an aircraft going down.